Thank you for joining us, sir.
Good morning, Chris. How are you?
Help me understand this apparent hypocrisy by your evangelical brothers and sisters. They seem to just be choosing policy over piety all of a sudden.
Well, I don't know if it's all of a sudden. I mean, I think every Christian understands that we are all sinners and we all make mistakes and we all do things that we shouldn't do. And we that's why, as a Catholic, as you know, we have confession. And, you know, we go there to confess our sins, and that and we should probably go every day. So I think there's a difference understanding that, you know, people are broken, people fail, people do a lot of bad things. And then the question is, well, but how do they behave on the issues that we've elected them to deal with? And I think that's, yes, they are, in effect, choosing policy over the personal.
Yeah, but I don't think it's that clean-cut a distinction, especially for this group of voters. Look, you were in there during the Clinton years, okay? This was not what was being said by this voting bloc then. This is not what was being said by you back then. You remember you called for Clinton to resign because he was going to be impeached and Lewinsky was too big a cloud over everything and he had to go. So when it suits the politics, the piety is great. And when it doesn't suit the politics, the piety is easily excused. And that is hypocrisy.
Well, that sort of goes on both sides. I mean, how many
people
were...
But let's just talk about this side, because they've made this their currency. This is why they are better than I am.
Well,
because their faith comes first. Rick, where is it now?
I disagree. I mean, the piety on, you know, look at the Me Too movement, and where were they when Bill Clinton was doing this? So, let's just be honest about all this. I mean, you're right. The politics seem to trump everything these days, and unfortunately, that is the case. As you've seen me on this network, I have not been any apologist for Donald Trump's actions when they go out of bounds.
But you're not going out of your way to talk about him with these affairs either, like you would the way you did with Bill Clinton.
Well, I didn't talk about Bill Clinton's affairs as much as I talked about Bill Clinton, and the reason he was impeached was not was his affairs, it was actually lying under oath. And that
about
those
the
are the
affairs.
Grounds.
Well, that's all you guys talked about.
I remember too. I was there. And the reality was that when the president breaks a law, that's a big deal. It's like the situation that we're dealing with the president and the investigation in Russia. I mean, what seems to be where this is heading is, what did the president do after the fact, and did he potentially do something that was harmful? Not really what was the underlying offense. So actually, how you deal with an investigation is, in fact, important. And telling the truth to the FBI is something that is a...
Well, we'll
that
see
is,
what happens is, here. This president is studiously avoiding, to this point, any kind of reckoning of the facts. But still, character either counts or it doesn't. Now, let's be very clear about this. I have been covering this Stormy Daniels story, and from a very definite perspective, which is the legalities create exposure here that we have to monitor and watch. I'm not covering it because private lives should dominate our public official analysis. I don't believe that. I've never believed it. Not about Clinton. I thought you guys were wasting our time. I wasn't even really in the business then. I was still a practicing attorney. And I think it now. However, with people who say they put faith first, character has to count. It always had. We've heard it time and time again. And now all of a sudden, everything is forgivable. They liken Donald Trump to King David.
Well,
you think that's a good, is that a good analogy?
Well, certainly King David was a very flawed man.
And what else did King David do that made him acceptable to Christians? And it was a fundamental aspect of the story in the Bible. Psalm 51, right? His heart bursting open with contrition for what he had done. That was fundamental to the forgiveness. It was fundamental to the acceptance of what he was as flawed, because he knew it. And he begged forgiveness and promised to live his life differently going forward. It's in the Bible story because it's fundamental to the reckoning of why you're okay with it. And we see none of that here.
It is fundamental, but the contrition was not to his fellow men. His contrition was to God. And that's what evangelicals are looking at, that this is an issue between President Trump and God, not between President Trump.
But isn't that convenient?
No, it's not convenient. It's an article of
faith. They judge things that are between man and God all the time when it suits them.
We judge actions. We don't judge the person. And I think people have been very clear, as I have, that the president's actions on many occasions are reprehensible. And I certainly disagree with a lot of the things that this president does.
I just feel if you put a D next to his name instead of an R, there would have been a lot of loud and proud people talking about it.
The fact of the matter is, and you'll hear this over it, that we had a binary choice in the 2016 election.
I get it, but that's still a rationale.
It's not a rationale. I mean, there are two people who we both think are flawed on many levels. And, well, one, I happen to agree with their policies. The other,
there wasn't
a third choice.
I hear you. A
legitimate third choice.
I hear you. Look, I get it. It's just, to me, it smacks of something really obvious. And if people are going to put their faith first, they're asking for a different level of examination. That's all. That's why I bring it up. Let me ask you something else about a different level of examination. I know you. I don't think you've been on since this discussion, but you know, I always like to give you a chance to answer.
I appreciate that.
To your own words.
Yeah.
You really believe that telling these kids in Florida you should go learn CPR was the right way to deal with what they've lived through and what they're asking for now?
Well, the fact of the matter is I did misspeak and using the term CPR, and I think Sanjay Gupta's job here at CNN is probably safe as being the medical commentator on things. But the reality is it obscured the larger point. The larger point, which is that what we've seen from all of these mass shootings, is that the positive things that have come out of these mass shootings are organizations and people who have actually focused on what we can do at our individual schools and communities to actually prevent these types of things. Things like Rachel's Challenge or even Sandy Hook Promise and other organizations that have said, what can we do in our community to, you know, promote mentoring, to stop bullying, to be more aware of the problems? And what I've seen happen here is avoiding the issues that are really actually unifying. I mean, that's really the most disturbing things.
Right.
Most
but
of the things that we can do
that
here,
with those being a distraction from the single metric that distinguishes the United States of America from all other developed countries when it comes to gun violence. We have more guns. Access to weapons matters. And it seems like you and others on your side of the fence are going after these kids who are survivors in the interest of political expediency.
Well, if there's anybody that's going after folks for political expediency, it certainly isn't me. I mean, I certainly respect their right to go
out
and protest.
Telling the kids, figure out what you could do, you know, learn how to deal. You know, the CPR comments smack like, learn what to do when other people get shot around you. That's the best we can do to help you not get hurt.
Well, obviously, obviously that was not the intention, nor has it been my suggestion throughout the course since these shootings. What I've talked about are broader things like mentoring, like fatherhood programs.
Look, they're part
and
of the
other
equation.
Things that are,
they're just not a main variable.
Actually, I disagree, Chris.
I think
they are the biggest. If you look at the organizations that have come up from Columbine and Sandy Hook and others effective, that have actually saved lives.
But
and if you
we
look
know
at
what
the
main
facts,
factor is.
No, I don't agree with that.
No,
and here's the problem,
Chris. But then you're missing
the
point, Rick.
The guns
matter. Access to the weapons matters.
Yeah, and we can have a policy debate on this, but what's happened, and it happened
to
me.
Because we get distracted by all these efforts to attack the kids and say that they're real, they didn't go to the school, likening them Nazis, making fun of young women, lying about what they do. That's what people on your side of the fence are doing. I don't hear them being called out.
I condemn that, too. I think, look, there's politics and hypocrisy on... Well, no, there's politics and hypocrisy on both sides of this debate. And the frustrating thing, and this is what I've been trying to get through, is that there are things that can unify us. Usually when we have an issue of national import and this horrific event and these horrific events at school, we can actually try at times to unite and see what we can do to work together.
Yes, my brother. And you got the President of the United States this morning tweeting that the Second Amendment will never be repealed. We must have more Who's calling for a repeal of the Second Amendment?
Justice Stevens did. But
he did not. It was in the context of a conversation about the fastest route to legal change. And, of course, if you didn't have a Second Amendment, you wouldn't have Heller. It would be easier to change the laws. He's not a politician. He's not in office. He's not the head of any kind of significant group. It's a boogeyman,
Rick. He was a former Supreme Court justice.
That does not breed unity. It's a boogeyman, and you know it.
Look, there have been boogeymans on both sides, and that's the point I've been trying to get to, which is there are things that, in fact, can unify us, and what we see is demonization. You point to the right. I will point to the left. Look at what they've done to Marco Rubio. I mean, Marco Rubio has been out there trying to do everything he can to stop these horrific events.
That's not true.
Engaging young people. That is true.
That's not true. He's doing negotiations. He's talked about the kinds of bills. He's not working on any meaningful restriction of access.
Because
he is trying to do some red flag work. That's all good and fine. But do not put Marco Rubio out there as someone who's at the forefront of the most progressive way ways to end these shootings.
This is the problem that we have here. If you don't agree with you on a particular solution that you agree to, that somehow or another you don't care about this. That's wrong,
that's your,
Chris.
That's your
you can't
take.
Demonize. No, you can't.
I'm not demonizing
people.
Anybody.
Yes, you are.
How
You're
so?
Saying that he doesn't care about trying
no,
to solve
I never
this
said
problem
that.
Because
I'll send you the transcript of this. You're thinking
okay.
it in your head because it's convenient.
Okay,
but it's
tell
not
me what
coming
you're saying
out of
then,
my
Chris.
Mouth.
Well, tell me what
I'm
you're
saying
then.
Is access about who gets weapons and how is the fundamental question in this situation. Okay? It just is. I'm not calling for a weapons ban. I'm not calling for anything. It's up to you and your ilk to figure out the answers.
Well,
but
it's not
access
my ilk. I'm
matters
doing what you do now.
How
but
we deal with the mentally ill, if you're talking about mass shootings specifically,
that.
Which is ignoring the larger problem of gun violence in this country, but that's fine. This matters too. It's a discrete issue. It has to be dealt with. On those two issues, Marco Rubio sat at that town hall. He says he disagrees with certain things about controls and background checks and how universal they should be. But those are fundamental questions. So don't put him up at the top of the leaderboard about who's trying to make the positive changes that would change this situation. However, it would be unfair to say he is doing nothing. I agree with that. I never said he was doing nothing. He's doing things, but to put him up at the head, that's out of convenience. That's not accurate.
Well, look, again, the idea that Marco Rubio or anybody who is out there trying to do things to solve these in areas that they believe could be the most effective, and if you look at it, are in fact the most effective, instead of focusing on—
How is anything other than controlling who gets weapons and how going to be the most effective? What's more effective than that when you're dealing with gun violence?
Create an environment at schools where there isn't bullying, where there is a sensitivity to people who have problems and be able to identify those problems and be able to get proper care to people. I mean, there are lots of things that we can be doing right now in our school, and in fact are being done
by a lot of
these organizations.
But they should be done in addition to, not exclusive of.
I agree.
That's the whole point.
I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't look at the area of access to guns, particularly when it comes to—
Do you believe background checks should be extended to all sales?
Background checks are almost universal as it is, and the,
no,
and the ones
not.
That are not, but it's just an number one, it wouldn't have stopped any of the school
but
violence.
But that's not a rationale for a good law.
But if it is a rationale for trying to do something that we know can be effective.
It
and,
can
and
be effective.
And the reality is
knowing
that we know that these
weapons,
other things are effective.
Knowing who buys weapons is fundamental to this.
People are
gun
breaking
owners,
laws, Chris. People
90
are committing
plus percent
murder.
Of the American
the
people say you have to have better control on who gets weapons and how.
I would
90%
agree,
of I would the people.
I would agree, Chris, that there's a narrative that somehow or another you can walk into a gun store and buy a gun and it, you know, as easy as
that's
going out and buying.
That's a false narrative.
It's a false narrative.
It's just like repealing the 2A, just like that we're going to ban weapons, just like this is
not,
a confiscation.
But
that's
the focus,
also BS.
But the focus, your focus, is on trying to tighten up a very small, quote, loophole,
no, it's not my
which
focus.
I don't believe
I'm
is a
I'm saying
loophole.
That any rational thinker who looks at the data on this issue, and by the way, the American people should remember, guys like you didn't even want the government studying this problem, said tax dollars shouldn't go to it, that just changed now. We don't even look at the damn problem with our best eyes and resources.
Well,
what does that tell you, Rick? But
well,
anyway, let's put that to the side.
Just because the government doesn't look at it doesn't mean there isn't a lot of research on this area. The government
but why
isn't,
would you
isn't
say the government shouldn't
source.
Look at it? Well, look, it's smacked of such obvious political convenience. Look, they say they're going to change it. We'll see. Access matters. This should be a big, fat debate on the floor of Congress. Here's what we know. Here's what we think we can do. Here's what I'm for. Here's what I'm against. And these people should be weighed and measured, and people should go out and vote on these things the way right now only the gun advocates do. But we're
and
not
this,
getting that.
And my,
we're not
and
getting
my,
it.
My
Rick,
point,
they won't
Chris,
do
is,
that.
My
Your
point,
leadership won't put it on the floor. They won't even have an open debate about it. Why?
And my point is, this is a horrific thing that's going on in this country, and that what we should be focused on is trying to unite this country around solutions that we can all agree
Agreed.
With and put our shoulder forward. But that's not being discussed, Chris. We don't talk about this. The media
it should
does
be part
not
of
focus
the discussion.
On this. But it's
100%.
Not been part of the. It's but it's not been part. And I blame myself. I mean, I said you know that you know wrong comment on
yep.
Sunday, and I got everybody off on a rabbit trail. And you know I blame
a lot
myself.
A people
for
agreed
that.
With you.
But
you got
well,
people putting up Nazi effigies of these kids
well,
who survived a murderous shooting. You have them lying about a young woman ripping up the Constitution when it was a target. They're
yeah.
lying. They're creating boogeymen. And nobody's calling them out. And that's why I want to end this conversation where we started it. What do you say to those people who are making the survivors down there into bad people and saying they should shut up and no one should listen to them because they're not going to come up with the solutions?
Yeah, I can, you know, look, I in the strongest possible terms, condemn both sides for personally demonizing people.
You sound like Trump after Charlottesville.
No, look, you can't get up there and say that the folks, that many on the left have not been demonizing as mindless shills of the NRA.
Fine.
I mean, come
Fine.
On. I mean, it's happening on both
Fine.
Sides.
No, I'll give
don't,
you that.
Don't do this Charlottesville stuff on me.
Oh, it is Charlottesville, and I'll tell you
it's
why. You're right to call out people on the left who say gun owners are inherently bad people.
And it's wrong.
I'm a gun owner, okay? So I understand that. What I'm saying is this. This is the specific instance we're dealing with. What they're doing with these kids, that's the state of play right now. That's what needs to be called out. And don't create some false equation with this and something else, because it's disingenuous to the truth of this situation. Then deal with this and just say, my people who are on my political perspective of this, don't demonize the kids. Do better than that. Make arguments. Have insights. Don't insult these kids.
Couldn't agree
They've lived
more
through
with
enough.
No, I absolutely agree that the demonization of opponents is wrong. When we do it, it frustrates me more because
They're
I
kids.
Actually believe we have the evidence on our side. And if we had a discussion on what the evidence is, we'd win. And if we have a discussion on, you know, how bad you are because you don't agree with my position, I think that just diverts away from the truth.